good to be in the presence of God.
Hallelujah.
I mean, I can say with me that it's good to be in the presence of God than elsewhere. Amen. I see a lot of faces, new faces. Actually, I'm from Bangalore, I'm not from Philadelphia. I'm from Bangalore back in India. And I've come here to visit my brother, who is a doctor here. And it's my privilege to be here in this church because I never planned this trip in this place, in the first place, okay? I never planned this trip, but I think it's God's purpose. That I'm actually here in front of all my senior people and who are more worthier than me. And thank you, Pastor, for giving me this opportunity. Okay, just bring greetings to you in the name of Jesus. Before I could do that, I want all of you to turn to your neighbor and tell him, I'm blessed you are here.
Amen.
Amen. God is good to us every time, every single time, though we are sinners, but then God is good and he is worthy of our praises. Amen. So for today's short meditation, I have like very short time and I would like to do justice to the timing and I would like to say something which the Lord is actually speaking through me. So people who stand here and preach, they have the responsibility to speak to the people, but above all, they are speaking to themselves because God has to speak through them.
Amen.
Amen. People who preach, they are not like, you know, a super, super holy people, but they themselves, God is speaking to them first.
Amen.
So I bring to you a message where God spoke to me, and then I would like to give it to you. Okay? So let's be in a prayerful attitude, and may God let God speak to each one of us. Today I would like to speak to you from the book of John. Actually, I was taking youth from the book of John, and I would like to take John chapter 3, verse 1 to 21, about a person called Nicodemus. Okay, so this is the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 1 to 21. I don't want anybody to read this, just project it over here if it is possible. John chapter 3, verse 1 to 21. So it's a life of a person, a Pharisee named Nicodemus. Okay, I know all of you have heard of this person called Nicodemus. All of you know this person. We have heard about him so many times, but I would like to bring some things which will make you know that there's something different in this person. Okay, the word Nicodemus means conqueror of people. The word Nicodemus means conqueror of people. He was an official of Roman Emperor. He was an official where he was also official and he was also a religious leader where people respected him. He was a Pharisee. Okay, Bible says he was a Pharisee. Now let me give you an example. Let me give you the definition of a Pharisee. A Pharisee, we all speak about them. We all speak that these people are not good. Jesus, when he was on the earth, he spoke against these Pharisees. But here are some of the things which is very interesting about Pharisees. Okay, they were very impressive to look. They were very religious people. They kept all the 10 commandments and the rules and the regulations. They fasted twice a week. They tithed 24% of their income. Irrespective of the 10% we speak out in our church, they tithed 24% of their income. This, it includes everything. They prayed 3 times a day. They were regular attenders of the synagogue or the temple. They had a high moral standard. They had a distinctive robes over their body. And, you know, they marked themselves out of an average person. They diligently studied the scripture. So we have in Jesus' time, you know, in Matthew chapter 25, verse 5 and 6, it is like Jesus speaking against them and telling them, everything they do so that men may see them, and they love the place of honor. That was the problem with the Pharisee. They did everything good. They came to church. They preached the word of God. They studied the word of God. But the problem is like they didn't have that in our lives. They didn't have that in their lives. They were far and far away from God. And Jesus, when he came to this world, he right at the center, he told them, you are far away from God. You are like the whitewashed tombs who can actually speak good words, but then it is not hurting. It is not actually penetrating inside your heart. So the word of God says to us, each one of us like this, let our heart be sober that we may receive the word of God. Amen. As a preacher, as a pastor, when I stand here, every time I preach, Lord, I don't want to be a person who just preach and go out, but I want to be a person who can actually make it happen practical in my own life first. That should be the prayer for each one of us. Let me come back to this person called Nicodemus. He was a Pharisee. So these were the things which he followed. Okay, we already saw that his in Bible it is his name is mentioned as Nicodemus Ben Gurion. That was his name, full name. But in English, when we come to English, it is like Nicodemus. We pronounce it very sharp. Okay, so which means that he was a conqueror of people. He was a Jewish ruling. He was a Jewish ruling council. He was a member of parliament. He was Israel's teacher, and he was a good teacher. He came to Jesus at night. Have you ever thought why he came to Jesus at night? People would say, look at him and say, this guy is a Jewish and he's coming to Jesus. They will make fun of this guy. That's the reason why he came at night to Jesus. But above all, I like this passage. Jesus is waiting for him. Jesus is waiting for him. It is not the timing of Nicodemus which made the difference. It is the timing of Jesus which made the difference. Amen. It was not the timing what he chose to come and meet Jesus. It was like Jesus was waiting at the right time when he came to see Jesus. Amen. And I'm telling you, that changed his perspective. That changed his life. That changed his entire lifestyle. That was Jesus who was waiting to receive Nicodemus. Now somebody, I know people here say, I went to God. I went to church. I am saved because of my effort and my work. Sorry, my dear brothers and sisters. It's a grace of God. It's a grace of God that I am saved. As Pastor Clay said, it's a grace of God that we all are here in this place. None of our talents, none of our works, or none of our ability, or none of our actual position can actually take you closer to God. Because God is God. We are men. And it's by His grace that we are standing here. Amen. If I think otherwise, I say, God, forgive me. If I think otherwise, if I think that it's because of my talent, or it's because of my money, or my position, or my tradition, sorry, it's not because of any of those things. God is God, and we are just men. This person came to Jesus, and I'm going to take you to three passages in the Bible where we see the life-changing experience of this person called Nicodemus, from being just coming to see Jesus to being his follower and to being martyr for Jesus Christ. I know it's not, you have never heard of this thing, but I'm going to tell you this thing. John chapter 3 verse 1-21 says that he came to Jesus at night. You know why? Because he liked Jesus. He liked Jesus. Today in this world we have so many people who like Jesus. They like everybody. They like so many people, and among them they like Jesus. If you come to India, if you say about Jesus, they say that, oh, he's a good man. I have a problem with that. He's not a good man. He's about that. We have so many good people around this world. We have so many good people and talented people around this world. Jesus is not that. Jesus is Son of God. God Himself. I have a problem with that when people say he's a good man. Okay? So here is a person who is, because Nicodemus is coming to Jesus because he liked Jesus. That's all. He had no relationship with Jesus. He had no affinity toward Jesus, but he liked Jesus. And we know what happened. Jesus spoke to him about being born again. Jesus spoke to him about coming back to life. Jesus spoke to him about a second birth. And we all know what happened at that time. Confused Nicodemus. He learned something else from his tradition. His tradition said something else, but this person is saying something else. His tradition said that, you know, you have to just follow rules and regulations. But here is some man who is saying that no rules and regulations, your relationship matters. It's not the rules and regulations which will take you to Jesus. It is your relationship with Jesus which will take you closer to salvation and closer to Jesus. Amen? And this person, he met Jesus, he came back after meeting Jesus. And now I want somebody to read, or I can actually project it here, John chapter 7. Verse 50 to 51. Maybe John chapter 7, verse 50 to 51.
Nicodemus, who had gone to Jesus earlier and who was one of their own number, asked, does our law condemn anyone without first hearing him to find out what he's doing?
Let's give you the context of this passage. Jesus is being produced in front of the council to be treated for the wrong he has done. Nicodemus is standing there. He was a member of the council, as I mentioned. He's standing there. You know what he's doing? He's defending Jesus.
Amen.
He's defending Jesus. Tell me where he was when he came to Jesus. Tell me where he was when he came to Jesus. He came to Jesus with doubts about life and things. He came to Jesus with so many confusions because his tradition is saying something else and Jesus is saying something else. But he found out that this person is right. This person is God himself. And he's now defending Jesus in front of the entire community. He came to Jesus by night in one instance. But his life is changed now. He's coming to Jesus back and he don't want to be ashamed of anybody. He's not scared of anybody. He's not scared of his Sanhedrin. He's not scared of council members. He just doesn't bother about them. He's just coming and defending Jesus by saying, do we have to trial this person without a fair trial? Do we have to, you know, make this person suffer because he just did something else? No, it's not right. That was experience change I'm speaking about. That was the change which he had when Jesus touched his life.
Amen.
I know you have testimonies. I know you, if I give you this mic, I know so many of you can come, friend, and you can tell me, you know, geez, I was going away and Jesus saved me. I was going away and Jesus held me back to his love. That is Jesus.
Amen.
We're back in India, we have problem with atheists. And I'm afraid atheists are people who are growing too much in this world. You know why? Nobody likes God. Yesterday I was in one church and that pastor was saying in Canada they passed the rule. A couple who got married and they had a baby. And the rule has been passed where they are saying that let the baby decide which gender he wants to. There is a rule passed in Canada where they're saying let the baby decide which gender he likes and which gender he wants to identify himself with. My heart broke when I saw that news. I have never thought in my entire life that something like that would happen. And here it is, the evil one, you know, blinding the people. Blinding the people, and here is Jesus who is opening the eyes of people. He's opening the eyes. And look at what is this world, what is it all about? I don't want to just mention, I don't want to go beyond this. And here, when he defends Jesus, he shows his love, his affinity towards Jesus. He's saying, Jesus, I know that you are God. I know that you are here unfairly. And I support you. I love you, Jesus. I know so many of you are called by the purpose which God has called. Are we going around in the city and sharing the love of God? Are we going around meeting our people? We in our office, we know that, you know, we are saved. That's not enough. We are just not saved. When we are saved, we have to go to the next level and sharing that love to somebody. Sharing that love to somebody. Do you know how many of you have bought these phones and you like this phone, any phone? Okay, if you like this phone, and you go to your friend and you say, Pastor, you know this phone? It's good. You should purchase this. Okay, this phone has this functions, this phone has this, you know, apps, and you can do so many things with this phone. You know what you're doing? You're sharing. When you are saved, God asks us to share his love towards another person. Share his grace and mercy towards another person who doesn't know Jesus. I'm telling you today, the threat of this world is not the Muslims or not the Hindus or not anybody. The threat of this world is atheists coming into this world. They are just all over the place. They don't know who is God. They don't know what God can do. They don't know who created this world. They are all confused people, but then they are growing. You know why? Nobody is there to share the gospel to them. I will just stop it here with one last verse. Somebody please take John chapter 19, verse 39 to 42. And here we see the person called Nicodemus had a tremendous change that he is now doing something more than expected. Even the disciples didn't do, and this person is doing. Somebody please take John chapter 19, verse 39 to 42.
Nicodemus also, who earlier had come with Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, but 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloth with the spices, as is the burial custom of Jews. Now, that the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and the garden a new tomb in which no man had yet been laid.
Now, you see something, some changes here? Can you just tell me the change, what the person brought for a person who came to Jesus at night? And to a person now who is actually a follower of Jesus. He's not stopping by just liking Jesus or by loving Jesus. He's now become the follower of Jesus. He become a follower of a great God. You know, there was this, that here when Jesus died and crucified and he was about to bury him, all the disciples left him. You know why? They all thought a different God who would actually come into this world and with sword and with spears and with army of angels, they would just overthrow the Romans. And you know what? There were two people, you know, that Thomas, the sons of thunder, they wanted Jesus to ask them pick his right and left. And there was somebody else who was, you know, worried about the position. Well, I want to be in this position when Jesus comes as Lord and King. And there were other disciples fighting among themselves. You know what? I am the greater among you. You know, I am better than you. I have better understanding about you, or maybe more than you. I know what Jesus is doing. And there were Peter and the great disciples, all these people standing far and saying, I don't know this person. Who this person is? Really? Seriously? This is Jesus? No, I don't. I've never been with this person. And all this drama is going on. There is one person called Nicodemus. He's standing right at the center, right at the foot of the cross, and he's saying, I know this person. I know Jesus. Because Jesus is the savior of this world. I don't want to just be liking Jesus, where I know this person, but I know that he can do something powerful in my life. I don't care about what position I can be. I don't care about where I stand or where I have position in my society. I care if I have the relationship with Jesus. Yes, I have minding about is where I stand in Jesus. Yes, I know the world is going towards a different end, and people are worried about position and places and money and tradition. But I am here to tell you it doesn't matter. For Jesus, it matters is the relationship. Yes, this person called Nicodemus, he was somewhere. God saved him. Now he became the follower of Jesus. You see in this passage, none of the disciples are mentioned here. None of the disciples are there, you know, when they're burying Jesus, because they're all discouraged. They were having high dreams of becoming some commanders and generals in the army of God. And there's nobody because Jesus is dead. And there's this person standing right there and is helping. Who has earlier come to Jesus by night came bringing the mixture of myrrh and loaves for 75 pounds in weight. It was too expensive. Let me give you this, what happened to Nicodemus. He was, that's not mentioned in the Bible, the history says, he was thrown out from the Sanhedrin. He was thrown out from the council of religious leaders, the Pharisees. He was stripped off from the position he was in the society. And he was thrown out from the Roman province. And later, it is said about Nicodemus that he went to a place in Europe and he became martyr for Jesus. He went to a place in Europe where he just laid down his life for Jesus because he understood nothing in this world matters more than Jesus to him. Amen. Let me ask you this question. Where do we stand here today? What is our position this morning as we, you know, hear the word and as I listen to this? What is my position? Where do I stand? Is it that I pray to God because I want something from Lord? Is it that I pray to God or I go to God because I need something in my life? Yes, Bible says that you will receive all the things. But seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. And all the things shall be added to you. It is not because I need something I go to Jesus. It's I want to have a relationship with that God. I was telling this day to one to the youths, how many of you know Trump? And they were all laughing at me. Everybody knows Trump. But I asked them, does Trump know you? They were like, quiet. But you know what? I know Jesus. Jesus knows me. Jesus calls me by name. Jesus has a purpose for me. For each one of us, he has called each one of you according to his glory and in his riches. He's a power. God who can change your life upside down. This is the God we serve. I just thank God for this day, and I thank you, Pastor, for giving me this opportunity. I have a church in Bangalore, and I pastor a church in Bangalore. I also lead worship in different places in Bangalore, and we also take worship seminars and counseling different couples. Pray for us that God may, as you know, that in India back situation is not same. You cannot share the gospel as you used to share the gospel. Okay, so our technique is different. We put a big label saying counseling for anybody. And there are people in the world that are suffering in their marriage. They come to us. We counsel them. We share God's word. We baptize them. And we have so many people now coming through counseling. Pray that actually God may. That's the second thing is music. The music is something we use attracted to. We go to colleges. We perform there. We don't perform any other song. We perform only the songs of Jesus. Because I believe the songs of Jesus are better than the world, the songs of his world. And they can actually change the hearts. So we sing those songs in the colleges, and these people come to us and they say, from where did you hear this song? We had never heard this song before. I said, yeah, you have to come to church, I will show you this song. You have to come to church, I will just make you listen to the song. And we have so many youths coming to our church. Pray for us, pray for the ministry, and that God may bless each one of us. Thank you, Pastor. God bless you all of you.